Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Pat Barrett.
Number two.
My name is Pat Barrett.
Number three.
My name is Pat Barrett.
And it's up to you, panel, if you really want to locate the real Pat Barrett. And this is his story. Please, read along with me. I, Pat Barrett, am a wrestler. I was the former World Heavyweight Tag Team Champion. I've butted heads with the famous bad guys like Nature Boy Buddy Rogers, Superstar Billy Graham, and wrestled with 600-pound Haystack Calhoun and another rather large fellow named Andre the Giant. Wrestling is one of the world's most popular sports. Surprisingly, in some countries, women make up 60% of the audience. But my life as a wrestler is lonely and very dangerous. It's tough dodging headbutts and dropkicks inside the ring, not to mention burning cigars and bottles thrown from outside the ring. On one occasion, I was confronted by a fan with a loaded pistol. Maybe that's why I called my new book, Everybody Down Here Hates Me, signed Pat Barrett. We are going to start the questioning off with Orson Bean.
Thank you. Well, now, when I was a kid, I used to go and see Gorgeous George and the Sweetest Angel. I love wrestling. Number two, like Cyndi Lauper, many women seem to love wrestling. Why do you think that is, number two?
They like brutality.
Brutality! I knew there was something about women I like. Number three, now, do you write with a pencil or when you write your books, a crayon? What do you... Number three, I mean no offense, please, in your own words.
This one talking, I don't know it.
I prefer number a crayon, three. But my wife usually types for me.
Ah, that's fine. Now, does she like brutality, like number two says, your wife?
No, she doesn't.
All right, number one. Now, what is the secret of the tremendous success that wrestling is experiencing?
It's exciting.
Exciting. It is exciting. How much of it is legitimate, number
thank
one?
Thank you. Thank
you can answer that.
No,
pay no attention to this man.
Pay
no attention to this man behind the
Mary
drink.
Ann Mulder.
Number one, there was a very famous Olympic wrestler, and he caught all of our attention. I think it's what he called a heavyweight wrestler in that heavyweight division, I should say. Do you remember who that was?
What year are you talking about?
The last Olympics. In the.
From what country?
From the United States.
For one thing, I'm not from the United States, and I don't know who you're talking about. The gentleman had cancer right before the Olympics, and he was 220 pounds in Greco-Roman. I can't think of his name right now.
And number two, what possessed you, I mean, I think it's wonderful, but what possessed you to do all of this? I mean, it's pain.
I was a nasty kid.
Number three? I mean, have you ever been out of commission for any length of time because of a headbutt or a drop kick?
Length of time, no.
Thank you, Marianne. David.
Okay, thank you. Number one, it says you were the former heavyweight champion. When were you the heavyweight champion?
1978.
And number two, I'm sorry?
Tag team.
Tag team, yes, thank you. Number two, who was your partner in the tag team?
Dominic DiNucci.
And number three, did your tag team have a name that we might know?
No.
Like the Road Warriors or something like that?
No, we didn't.
Oh, okay.
No. Thank you, David. Oh, Kitty.
Number one, what nationality are you?
Originally?
Yeah.
I'm from Czechoslovakia. Oh.
And number three, is it not true that very strong men who are capable of inflicting pain are generally very, very gentle?
I wouldn't know.
Kitty, number two, why did they come at you with a pistol?
They didn't like me.
Why?
Because they thought I was a nasty guy, I guess.
I didn't understand that. But number one, why did they come at you with a pistol?
We were wrestling in Mexico,
uh-huh.
And we were thrown off the ring as we were wrestling, and someone tried to hit my partner with a board. I tried to help him, and someone pulled out a gun to my head.
Oh, my goodness. And
thank you, Kitty. Obviously, overzealous fans. Your time is up, and it's time to vote for either number one, number two, or number three? We'll start with Orson.
Well, number one could be the Czechoslovakian mauler. Number two, I was all set to vote for him, but when number three said that, I thought he was maybe a butterfly collector or something. But when he said, I wouldn't know. I can picture him standing with that little bald referee and then say, I'm going to kill the guy.
Marianne.
Well, I know I made a mistake earlier in the program, but I know without a shadow of doubt that I am right this time.
Absolutely.
Because my husband went down to judge the Miss Mexico pageant, and they didn't like the choice, so they had to get the judges out under armed guard. It's number one. I know it.
Because he said Mexico.
No, it's just I know it. But my hand hurts.
Well, I think, as usual, the imposters are brilliant, and the Mark, and this whole show does everything they can to confuse me, and I figure that the guy in the middle is, with all due respect, so small that that is the most unlikely one, so I know it's got to be him.
Pick the small guy. Kitty.
Well, I didn't vote for number three because they always try to fool you with the one that looks like he's supposed to be the real one, and goodness knows, number three looks it. And number two, I just didn't believe, and I voted for number one. He looks gentle, and most of those folks are gentle.
Okay, well, our panel is split on their vote. There was one vote for number one, two votes for number one, one vote for number two, and one vote for number three. Now let's find out who the real writing wrestler is. Will the real Pat Barrett please stand up? Aha! Very, very, very good. Let's find out who our imposters are. Number one, your name and what do you do?
My name is Stephanos Miltsakakis. I'm from Greece. And I work at a club called Roxbury at the door.
Oh, yeah. I've been there. Nice place. Boogie time. Thank you. Number three, your name and what do you do?
My name is Conrad Richardson, and I buy and sell antiques and collectibles.
Old butterfly next. Well, there are three incorrect votes. At $500 a vote, your team will win $1,500. Now, Tarek, come on out here. Let everybody take a look at you. Now, everybody says he's a real nasty guy. But look at him. He's not that big. What in the world provokes you?
People...
Whoa! My dear, right? We'll be right back to play one-on-one with someone from our studio audience. That's if I'm available right after this.
New Pillsbury Streusel coffee cake. Now you can have coffee cake.
Time to play one-on-one with someone from our studio audience. Burton, who do you have for us?
Lynn, meet Rich Van Dam from Roselle, Illinois.
Rich, Thanks. Welcome to Tell the Truth.
Thanks, glad to be here.
Here's your chance to play one-on-one. I want you to meet two sisters, Julie and Jenny. Welcome, Julie, Jenny. Julie and Jenny are going to tell us two stories, only one of which is the truth. If you spot the true story, you'll win $500. So, Julie, tell us the first story.
My sister Jenny and I are the world champion log rollers.
Now, that may or may not be the truth, so listen to the second story. Jenny?
My sister Julie and I are in the Army. We were the first sisters to fight side by side in combat.
Okay, panel, to help Rich win $500, you'll ask one question about each story. Let's start with Julie and the story about the log rollers. Kitty?
How did you get the job being a log roller?
Our mom was a log roller and she started us.
David?
I don't know anything about log rolling, but, I mean, what is the wood made of? I mean, what type of tree?
Cedar wood.
Okay. What's a wood made of? I'm glad you qualified that with cedar. Marianne.
I thought I'd been dumb, but that was dumb.
That was a pretty dumb one.
That was dumb. And I love to watch the log rollers. Do you do that together? I mean, on the log at the same time?
Yes, sir. There's two people.
Okay. Orson?
Well, I always knew that such things were genetic. The mother was a log roller. Now, as a fan of the Twin Peaks log lady, I'm interested to know... Where do you compete in these log rolling contests?
The Pacific Northwest.
Okay, Rich, you've heard their first story. Now, Jenny and story number two, the Army sisters. Kitty.
What battle did you fight side by side in?
In Panama, ma'am.
David?
How much training did you have here before you took off to Panama?
We've been in the service for 6 years. And...
Mary Ann?
Where did you do your basic training?
In South Carolina.
Orson,
are you both the same rank or is one higher?
Actually, we're both the same rank. Yeah. Staff sergeant.
Now, Rich, you heard the cross-examination. Are Julie and Jenny champion log rollers, or are they in the Army?
I don't think they're in the Army, because I don't think it's just like you couldn't have the two sons together and their sisters. So I'm going to go with the log rollers.
Okay. Julie, Jenny, what's the true story?
To tell the truth, we are the world champion log rollers.
$500. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks for playing one-on-one. We'll be right back after these words. This edition of To Tell the Truth. We'll see you all next time. Bye-bye.
This is Burton Richardson speaking for To Tell the Truth, a Mark Goodson television production.
Tonight after Unsolved Mysteries.
TV, here's how I watch a wrestling match. Oh, that looks so painful. Well, it's probably fake. It's all fake, isn't it? I don't know. It's looking kind of real. But if it's real, how do they get back up? I mean, that's how I watch wrestling, because you go, is it, isn't it, is it, isn't it? Well, Irish Pat Barrett is with us today. He's wrestled with some big names all over the world, and he's written a book about his experiences called Everybody Down Here Hates Me. Who hates you?
Well, you know, the name isn't just for me alone. It's for wrestlers in general. Let me tell you why.
They get no respect?
Well, they get respect, all right, up to a point. Here's a scenario. Football player goes into a store.
Uh-huh.
Someone comes up and says, hey, I saw you. See, you play football. Let me have your autograph.
Right.
Guy signs it up, pats the kid on the head.
Right.
And he struts in his merry way. No problems. Wrestlers in the store. Person comes up and says, God, I've seen you. You're so-and-so wrestling. He says, yeah. Let me have your... My kids love you. Let me have your autograph. Signs the autograph, and the guy goes, yeah, yeah. Let me ask you something. Now, that wrestling's all fake, isn't it? And if the wrestler's not careful, within 2 seconds, he's in a punch-up in the store, right? And then if he goes to court, because he invariably gets sued, it happens to a lot of wrestlers, when he's sued, there's no point in him getting up in front of the judge and saying, I'm an actor. Because you know what the judge says? No, you're not. I don't watch wrestling, but my kids do. You're one of those brutes I've seen with those brutal holes. Bump. And he nails them. So you see, wrestlers can't win for losing.
But there are some other people that, because you wrote this book, who are not real pleased with you. You make people a little nervous.
Well, a lot of the magazines now are... You know, wrestling now has become very, very glitzy. It's always been... There's always been millions of people watch it. But it was a sort of closet thing. It was 11 o'clock at night. People mm-hmm. snuck out in the living room and switched on the TV. Mm-hmm. And car dealers were the ones that sort of sponsored it, etc., right? But now you have a much greater audience out there.
It's downright chic to watch wrestling.
Yeah, right. And, of course, the magazines, the answer I got from them when I wanted to advertise my book mm-hmm. in some of the wrestling magazines was... we have audiences or people who buy the magazine from 13 to 29, mm-hmm. and it's not suitable. Now, think about it. 13 to 29, And my book.
Those are the kids who are buying the magazines, age 13 to 29.
And
I think
so
we
what?
Got some in our audience today.
Right.
13 to 29. Anybody fit in that category? I think so.
Anyway.
See, your book. Your book has got some pretty gory, ugly stuff in it, which you say is kind of cleaned up. You're bad for business. That's why they're.
Well,
so
I'm
nervous.
Not. I'm not bad for the wrestling business, but I'm bad for. Let's say the magazines don't, you know, they don't want people to know the truth, that blood is real. I mean, everyone for years has said fake blood. And in the old days, promoters used to fight that. They used to say, no, you know, no, it's not. Of course it's real blood. Real blood is easy. I mean, you know, I mean, I would prefer to be bleeding, let's say, in the nose. I went to a doctor in time to get take my blood.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he couldn't find the veins. I got deep veins. He tried here. He tried here. He tried the backs of my legs. He tried... In the end, I said, look, please, just punch me in the nose, and let's get it over with.
Oh, come on.
I'm serious. I would sooner bleed than, let's say, someone throws a drop kick at me. He misses, but I try to turn, and I tear my cartilage out, right? I'm laying there on the canvas, moaning and groaning, and what do people say? Look at that. The guy never even hit him, and he's moaning and groaning. It's fake.
Okay, tell me the story of the woman... When you were fighting and the guy cut you over the eye and you were going out through the crowd,
yeah.
That this woman was so desperate to find out if it
was
fake.
Well, a guy used a knuckle duster on me, what we call a salmon killer. So, it's an eye, and he hit me across here. I've got the scar to this day. Anyway, I was being carried out, Boston Gardens, being carried out on my back, and I look up and the crowd was pressing forward, and this angelic lady came up and looked at me, and she was looked like somebody's grandmother, and she smiles at me. She said, "How are you, Patty?" I said, all right. And she went like that, and I was covered in gore. I mean, from head to toe, because this cut had really bled. My eyelid was hanging down. And she went like that, and she scooped up a big handful of it, and she went... God, she said, it's real blood. It's real blood, everybody. Now, I don't know how she knew by tasting it it was real blood. And, I mean, my eyelid was hanging down, but you see, the doubt was still there in her mind. And so it makes me laugh, because when people say to me, is it fake? I say, okay, first of all... Let's start with, if I say it's not, do you believe me?
No.
And most of them say no. So then
right.
I say...
Does anybody believe him if he says...
So,
what?
Well,
yeah, you're
okay.
Right. Nobody's going to believe
so
it.
So if someone says that, then I say, well, why do we bother even discussing it? What I would say to you is this. I will tell you stories about things that happen. Mm-hmm. All of them are true. Like in the book.
Yes.
Every story in that book is true. There's no whitewashing it or whatever.
Let's take this phone call. Andrew in Tampa. What do you want to know?
I'm curious that... do any wrestlers actually... cut themselves with razors or other objects intentionally, or is that done by the opponent usually?
Well, you know, it's like in the boxing business, they've got cut men in the corner. They say it right out loud. Guy gets a big bruise or what have you. Once they want to release the blood, the pressure, the guy cuts the bruise. That's how he lets the blood. Sure, the wrestlers do all kinds of things to you know, whatever. You know, but that doesn't mean that they go out and maim themselves.
Well, you know, but here's the thing. When you watch it on TV now, you know, you got in the business, I don't know what, 20, 25 years ago or something.
When I was three.
When you were three. and you're 33 now. But now, compared to what it used to be a number of years ago, and it just like one of these no holes barred, everybody just get out there together and anything goes, now it looks like a theatrical production. It's slick. They have gorgeous costumes. They have commercial breaks. It looks choreographed now.
Think
that's
about,
why people always say, is it fake?
Let me address the costumes first. See, wrestling has always been in the forefront of professional businesses when it comes to going that bit further. Mm-hmm. Gorgeous George back in the 40s. People like Cassius Clay and Muhammad Ali copied them, said so in his book. He had the robes.
Mm-hmm.
He had the perfumed hair. As George Wagner, as a wrestler with cropped hair, he never made a penny. The guy was a great amateur wrestler. But when he blitzed himself up a bit, wouldn't let the referee touch him, get your filthy hands off me, he made, they figure, probably $4 to $5 million in the 1940s. Now, can you imagine how much money that is? So wrestling has always been the robe and what have you.
Right.
But now what you see on television, of course, is probably a 2.5-hour program. And I'm not letting any secrets out. It's a 2.5-hour program.
But it looks cleaned up.
Of course it's cleaned up. You see, because it's cleaned up. In other words, they cut it out. I mean, television, for everybody, we're even cleaning up wars now, right? So they're cleaning up the wrestling business from the point of view. What's seen on television is what the promoters want you to see. They don't want to freak the non-wrestling fans out by showing, like, maybe some wrestler, first of all, punching some of the fans out because they try to... hit him with a chair.
Which actually happens.
Oh, all the time. 2x4, they try to... Look what, I'll show you something. England. Little old ladies in England carry these in their purses.
What are those little stick pins?
They're hat pins. And they carry these so they can stab the wrestler of their choice.
Oh, no. Come on.
I am serious. Little old ladies come at you. Now, the funny thing is that when they come at you, when they get that excited, if they can't get the wrestler they want to get, then they get any wrestler they can. So some guy drops out in front of their feet, and she reaches in her purse and goes, wham! You know, up. And these have been taken over, been taken off people. These are the actual things.
Have you ever been stabbed?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Well, I don't want to see it, but I just, you know, want to know. We better take a break.
All right.
On this note, with the hat pins from the little old ladies in England, we'll be right back with Irish Pat Barrett. Today is pro wrestler Pat Barrett talking about some of the things that go on behind the scenes. I know you have a question. Go ahead.
Yeah, I've been a wrestling fan for years, and I enjoy it because it's athletic entertainment. What made you feel you needed to write this book?
Well, I've had a lot of people ask me questions over the years, and I would tell stories, and they say, gee, you know, I can't believe it. Has that really happened? And I started writing the book and just to amuse myself, and some people who read it said, boy, that's great. Why don't you try putting it in print? That's why I did it.
Dave in Tampa, go ahead.
So, excuse me. I would like to ask Pat if officials, referees, or generally have a hand in determining the outcome of the matches, because I've seen the various significant wrestling matches where referees are accidentally knocked down and then only to recover in time to count the pinfall.
Well, you know, referees have got a horrible job in any sport, in wrestling especially. Because you got two guys in there. I see, what people don't understand is, you audience out here, one of you are in a bad mood, you go to work, the worst you can really do, you can't get up into a punch-up with your cohort. You get fired. A wrestler gets in the ring, he's in a bad mood, he takes it out on whoever's around there, the wife is throwing him out, won't let him home the night before he came home drunk, or whatever. What I'm saying is, the poor old referees, I wouldn't be a referee for $1 million. Because you got two guys in there, usually two, maybe four. The rings are not that big. And they're moving around. They hit these referees. They have a certain amount of contempt for them. I mean, when you're 260 pounds, I'm one of the smaller wrestlers. It's very difficult to look at a referee that weighs 160, you know, as an equal and whatever. So referees have got a dreadful job.
You know, but you hold no punches in your book about some of the dirty things that go on, especially earlier in your career.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a story in the book where one of the guys... you have your hand in his mouth, thinking you're going to get him like this, mm-hmm. and he clamps down on your fingers, and you start to bleed, and so you do what to him?
Well, I was dumb enough to think this was a hold I'd been shown by another wrestler. He said it's infallible, you know, when you hit him in the stomach, when their mouth's open, clamp on their jaw. And for him, it was infallible. This guy had fingers like bananas, although not a big man. But when I did it, it wasn't infallible. This guy started biting my fingers off. Well, there's only one. You've only got one hand left. There's only one thing you can do. And I did it. I grabbed him by the crown jewels and threw him into a bookcase. I twisted it before I did to get him on his toes because he's lighter then.
Is that still happen?
Oh, all the time. Of course it happens. It's a hard, brutal world out there. And in the wrestling business, you know, especially.
Go ahead.
What is your most serious injury that you've had in your career?
Well, I've had a couple. I had a torn intestine, which was very bad. And when I was in Mexico, I got kicked in the wrong place, well, right behind, actually, and almost died. And the bad thing was that I had a Mexican doctor who probably was quite good. I now know what it's like to be pregnant because I was lying on my back with my legs up in the air like this, naked, with this Mexican doctor underneath, cutting away with a scalpel, and he was cutting away all this bad stuff. And I'm talking to him, saying, is everything okay down there? And he kept saying, see. And I thought to myself, he keeps saying, see all the time. So in the end, I said, you're an SOB. And he said, see. And I realized he couldn't speak a word of English. He was just going, and I thought to myself, I hope this guy likes gringos.
You know, if this is so brutal, I mean, it makes you kind of go, why would anybody do this? It's I mean, are you crazy?
Yeah. All wrestlers are a bit crazy. You've got to be. Look, and there are guys that like, I mean, in this world, how much adventure is there? You know, and in this world, it is one of the most adventurous sports.
You
take your chances with the promoters. You take your chances with the wrestlers. You definitely take your chances with the fans. I'll tell you a scenario that the average, nobody else I don't think comes up against. A football player goes on vacation somewhere in the world. He gets away from everything. He's walking on the beach. Let's say he goes to India. Nobody knows him in India. I don't care how big a star he is in this country. Nobody knows him in India, right? He walks down the street. He's just another white man coming down. A wrestler goes to India, right? Now, he's one of the guys that's hated here. So let's say a barbarian, anyone like that, right? And they hate him here. He's one of those guys that you see on television that everyone hates. He goes to India. What he doesn't realize is he's just as hated over there, probably, because they see him on television there. And so he's walking down the street, minding his own business, and 200 or 300 people try to stone him to death.
Gee.
See? To think that... And
hated here, hated there.
Well, this is the kind of thing I talk about. And yeah, you know.
We have to take a break, and we'll be back with Pat Baird in just a moment. First, I want to tell you about an upcoming program here on Eye in Tampa Bay. Is there an ugly side to cosmetic surgery? Can breast implants lead to serious illness and chronic pain? Well, on Thursday, February 7th, we're going to meet several women who have had breast implants and are not very happy with them. In fact, very unhappy. Maybe someone you know has had a bad time with implant surgery and would like to share their story. We would very much like to hear from them or you. Give us a call or you can be in our audience. We'll be right back. Talking to wrestler Pat Barrett today, he brought along a picture that is pretty compelling. This is a picture of you and Andre the Giant.
Yeah, we've got Andre the Giant here. We've got Dominic DiNucci beside me, who is my
partner. Point out you.
This is me here.
Okay, there you go.
It's Andre. Andre had been my partner in several matches.
Oh, he was your partner. You were fighting
against
him.
He had been my partner. I'd partnered him. Dominic was my normal tag team partner when we held the WWF world title. That's Blackjack Lanza here, and this is a Japanese. Anyway.
Just a touch of a weight difference here, isn't there?
A little bit. Yeah, a tad.
Gee whiz.
What I want to show you is here, on the top of the picture, you can see...
Point it out so our viewers can see
it.
There you go.
In the top of the picture here, you can see the netting.
And that's
to stop the missiles coming in.
Missiles?
Well, whatever people want to throw.
Oh, my gosh.
You see? And, of course, that's... And down on the bottom, if you have a look, they got plastic shields.
Also to keep people from throwing things
BB
in.
BB guns or whatever else that they may bring in, or any kind of projectile. Low-flying low-flying foreign bodies that may come your way.
You had in your book, you tell the story of a Mexican wrestling partner who was killed.
Yeah.
The
fans, when he came out after the matches, he was surrounded by half a dozen fans, got into an argument with them, and they stabbed him in the heart and killed him. Well, wrestlers have killed each other. Outside, last year, one of the wrestlers got into a fight. They kept getting into fights outside the ring, and they tried to talk it out in the toilet. Actually, it was a shower room, and one of them was 6'6". Brody was his name, a big man. The other was about 230 pounds. The smaller wrestler pulled a knife, cut his stomach open. His intestines fell out.
You talking about the old days, or is this sort of stuff still happening today?
Last year. And the smaller wrestler didn't try to cut his throat. But here's the thing. The smaller wrestler, they got him out of this. He went up and wrestled a 30-minute match as Brody was dying. He then came down, had a shower, went home.
I think he was hitting the head a few too many times, don't you?
Hi, my name is Shannon Rose. I'm the host of Pro Wrestling Weekly on Public Access. I was just wondering, are you still actively wrestling?
Oh, I do. I do tours mostly because I go to Europe and work as a consultant and wrestle a bit.
He's obviously still crazy, isn't that right, Pat?
Of course.
Mark in Spring Hill, go ahead.
Yeah, hi. I saw a while ago a wrestler from the NWA, and he said that the more you bleed, the more the wrestlers get paid. And what he actually said is that red turns into green.
All the thread turns. Well, they don't get paid anymore. All the thread turns into green. But, you know, if people, a lot excites people. You know, it just...
We're kind of a violent society when you think about it, aren't
we? Well, like I was saying, I always tell people, if you think that we're not a violent society in this country, why are we so many lawyers? It's just lawyers are violence without the physical aspect of it.
Ooh.
In the old days,
interesting
if you got
point.
Into a fight with someone, you said, I'm going to clean your clock, and he said, okay, come on, Buster. Now we say, I'm going to clean your clock through this guy.
Ah.
And then you
good
say,
point.
No, you're not.
Good point.
I'll get you through this guy.
So and on that, we'll take a break. Barrett has certainly been enlightening us about the world of wrestling. A word, if you will, about the women of wrestling, the fans who want to get close to you.
Well, first of all, 60% of the audience, the adult audience, are women. They love wrestlers. I mean, it is their sport. There's guys, big hunky guys with almost nothing on, running around. So women like it. Yeah, there's women that like the bad guys, and there's women that like the good guys. And they don't usually mix.
But you kind of talk about how they offer things, too.
Of course they offer things. I mean, they offer themselves. Sure. It's part of the perks of being a wrestler. What do you think keeps half of them in the wrestling business?
Ooh. Nasty,
now the
nasty.
Wives will be hating him.
I know. Now they're really going to hate him.
I was curious as to how you actually get involved and get started in professional wrestling.
Well,
like you'd want to?
Of course.
Well, he's
not?
A big lump. Look, I'm strong as a horse.
Everybody told me I'd always be good at it. So it's...
Well, you know, size is not necessarily what... I was an amateur, but there are schools that do it. So if you look around, I think in this local area there may be one. Larry Malenko, the right local man here, he'll tell you.
Bill.
And he's easy to get a hold of.
A call in Palm Harbor from Bill. Go ahead.
Pat, isn't the winner of a match preconceived by contract?
By contract? I don't think I've ever signed a contract in my life. Wrestlers don't. Most wrestlers. Now, some now have contracts with promoters, but normally, wrestlers don't have contracts. If you get injured, that's it. Forget it. Now, nowadays, some have contracts because the promoters want to hold on to them. But that's the only reason. Contracts.
Did you change the names of some of the people mentioned in your
book? Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah. Well, you know, there's still a lot of them. A lot of them are still in the business. You know, and I talk in the business about a certain amount of those homosexuals in the business and what have you. I talk about the sex. I don't want to give their names out. It's not my right. But I tell the stories as they were.
So it's more to protect them than you?
Oh, yeah. I don't care. I mean, hey, I'm in the business. I've paid my dues. Yeah, not to protect me.
Okay. Pat Barrett is in town. He's got his book, Everybody Down Here Hates Me. We'd like to give you the information if you'd like to either obtain the book and get ready. It's quite a rocket ride to read this thing. And he's also here for a book signing. Let's give people that information. Pat Barrett. Fascinating stories behind the scenes of pro wrestling. Got more than a few people calling us up, a little nervous about what you were going to say today, but I think we'll all agree we all learned a little bit about pro wrestling. Thanks so much.
And Maxine has been successful in his appeal against the decision in his Rocco bout. And a warm welcome from the National Garden Festival here in Stoke, where once again we bring you International Satellite Wrestling. Tonight featuring Screaming Eagle, Mad Dog Wilson, Bone Crusher Pat Barrett, Soul Man Bond, Steve Fury, Gaylord Peacock, Mickey Gold, and Mark Rollerball Rocco. Hello, first a roundup of wrestling news, and it's a case of good news, bad news for Chick Cullen fans. The good news is Chick has secured a very lucrative long-term contract in America.
Rosegun, I don't believe this is happening now. The second of our quarterfinal. From Deptford, London, the Soul Man, Dave Bond, V. Bone Crusher, Pat Barrett. A man who just does not care. There's the bell. We had 30 seconds of action there before the bell was even struck.
And the bout's now officially on. Max, I've got to talk to this guy later. He looks an absolute lunatic, Barrett.
Oh, drop kick. Barrett on the receiving end.
And the cameraman's in for some now.
Come on, enter. Aye, aye. What?
Come on.
And the bouts come out of the ring, and we're into tools. He's got a chair.
And this audience, very hostile to Pat Barrett, made some very heavy references to us English earlier on.
That a man?
And the man just doesn't care. He's totally fearless. But he's got a big one on today. The soul man, Dave Bond. Comes from a judo background.
And the judo's working the other way at the moment, Max.
The soul man back to canvas.
Come on, don't be using the ropes.
Toe hold against the ropes.
Don't be using the ropes.
Illegal use of ropes,
get
Max.
Off our ropes.
Absolutely.
Get off our ropes. Come on. Don't be using the ropes.
And Billy Finley keeping a very, very close watch on this.
Yes, he's not happy.
Oh, yes, solar plexus.
Oh.
And Bond bounces back. Forearm. Forearm. Oh, the nut. The nut goes in and Barrett goes out.
Inside.
Dazed. Very dazed.
And Bond's behind
him. And Bond's out with him as well. And
oh,
once again.
Again. Oh, Bond's
outside,
gone for
we're
a walk.
Amongst the crowd.
He's going for a
and
walk.
And they're into the amplifier, the PA of the hall.
Inside. Come on.
Oh, yes. And this is a turnaround. This is a turnaround. And we're here. Oh, with the ball. We hear that. This is unreal. Right in our commentary position. And I don't believe it's happening. Right, very near our commentary position. Goes for a cover. It won't happen here. We've got to get back in the ring. Billy Finley can do nothing against these two colossuses of the canvas. Goes for a choker. He's going for throws Billy Finley out of the way.
Oh,
this is unreal.
Bond is in big trouble.
This
Max.
Is unreal. Oh, come on. Public warning.
Public warning.
Man goes psycho.
In fairness, Max, he didn't start it.
Get in! Inside!
More inside. Work, Billy Finley. Virtually helpless.
No, the bout's back on in the ring. His name's Bond. Soul Man Bond.
I don't get in! Stop back!
Bond tries to get back. And here we go. What an encounter!
Ropes,
whoa!
Ropes, no.
Oh, and look, see,
oh,
Stuart.
No, no.
You can witness this now.
This is illegal.
Using
and
the
Bond's
top of his
in
gear.
Trouble. Bond's in bad
oh,
trouble. Oh,
Bond. Bond is regurgitating ropes. Something there. This is awful.
Come on.
I don't. Ropes. It was right across the windpipe there. Bond in trouble.
Right, Bond. Stand back.
Oh, no, he's not going to make it, Stuart.
No, I don't think so.
The man is not going
to... Jump back!
Soul Man Dave Bond, often described as the Caribbean Cyclone. But I'm afraid he's in the doldrums at the moment.
Forearm!
He's back.
Solar plexus straight... Oh, punch for punch, toe for toe.
It's a boxing match.
Oh, and the knot once again. Barrett in the corner.
Post.
Oh, yes.
Ow! Oh.
Goes ow. For a body check. And as always,
got
Barrett
him.
Interferes with the corner padding.
That's it.
And that's it over.
That's it.
Well,
Barrett's
what a turnaround.
Ladies and gentlemen,
it's not enough.
Of the 20-minute contest.
Stuart had such hopes for this man.
Despicable, Max. This is despicable.
Barrett, it's all over and he's still inflicting pain. I don't believe it.
I told you I was going to be the winner.
Told you I was going to be the winner. He makes these predictions every time. An unbeaten record on Screen Sports Satellite Wrestling, where the action is.
I think you ought to interview him later, Max.
I have with me Gaylord Peacock. Gaylord, welcome to Satellite Wrestling.
Good evening, how are you?
Well, I'm smashing, thanks very much indeed, it's nice to see you. You're going in with Steve Fury, Gaylord. Have you met this man before?
I've never met him before, but I've seen a few of his videos, and he's quite a good wrestler, but I'm the cure, he's the disease.
Oh, well, there you go. There you got it. There from the man himself. Steve Fury's been putting a lot of words about, saying you've been avoiding him. What do you think of this?
I don't think so, you know. He doesn't go to the same places as me. but I've not been avoiding him. But when we get in there, different story, you see. Different story.
Well, there you have it from, God bless you, from Gaylord Peacock. Now a commercial break.
Welcome back to Satellite Wrestling, and I have with me now Bone Crusher Pat Barrett. Pat, would you like to tell us about your rather unorthodox usage of chest expanders in your last match with Dave Taylor? We've had a lot of letters about that.
What do you mean? What was wrong? What were the letters all about?
Well, people tended to think that it was slightly odd getting chest expanders on the guy in the ring.
I was just trying to show this man, right? He's a young, fresh English heavyweight. I'm trying to show him how to build a body like mine, how to get the physique that's made me world famous, right? And he's such an idiot. He happened to hit himself on the head with it. He just didn't know how to use it. Now, all these people at home that are watching television, if they couldn't see that, is that my fault? I mean, just because he got a big lump on his head, just because he was almost knocked out, in fact, just because he couldn't continue the match, can you blame me for that?
Well, I think we might get a lot more letters about that.
By the way, did you hear all that banging going on? You know what that is?
What?
It's all those beautiful girls out there who want to see the Bone Crusher, who want to date with him. But let me tell you something. The Bone Crusher is not available. I'm just in this business to make money, not kiss all you girls. So please, stop beating on the doors. Please.
Now, your sleeper hold speciality has caused some controversy on this side of the Atlantic as being an illegal move. Is there any other major difference that you can think of between wrestling here and in the States?
Listen, I don't see any difference anywhere. I make my... God, get that girl out of here. You can't get with me. Get her out of here. I don't care how good-looking you are. Let me tell you something. I don't see any difference at all. When I get in the ring, I get in there and I wrestle fair. I just do all the rules. I never break any of them, right? I just listen to the referee when he... And you stop wagging your finger at me. When he tells me to stop, I stop.
All
right. I don't see any difference.
Current betting is at 9-4 on you on the tournament.
Who's betting?
Are you going to be putting any money on yourself for those odds?
9-4? You mean 9 of... You mean it's not 100-1 that I'm going to be the winner?
Not at the moment.
God help those poor idiots such that. Of course I'm going to bet every penny I've got, and that's a lot of money. A lot of money. But I'm going to clean up in every way. Every way possible.
Pat Barrett, thanks very much indeed, and back to Max ringside.
Bye, you all.
Well, there we go. The word...
America. John, welcome from all British fight fans here. And how are you looking forward to your pairing with Bone Crusher Pat Barrett over here?
I am looking forward to it, but I'm not a man to do a lot of talking about things like this. People are going to see Barrett and I in action, and the seeing is believing.
That's fine. All right, we're going to move over to Pat Barrett. Pat, have you got any tactics for this particular tag bout?
Tactics? What do I need tactics for? What does John Quinn and I do? Tactics? You know what we're like? Just a minute till I have the breakfast of champions here.
Mm, smells delicious.
I've just come back from Australia. Two Australian yobs said they were going to come down here and take care of me, right? I said, don't bother coming up. I'm coming down. By the way, would you like to try a little of this?
Not just yet. Not just yet. No, thanks, pal. I'll maybe have some.
Just have some. That'll keep you quiet.
That's very, very warm. Very, very hot, that, pal. That's very hot, John. And for me... Have you got any water there?
Sure. Listen, why don't you
let me do
the interview?
No, just a minute, Pat. I'll I'll do this now. John, in a room, it's okay.
You're English, aren't you? You can't take this good food.
I need an asbestos throat.
Good food or good fighting.
John,
if you English people would eat some of this stuff, this is what makes me a champion. This is what makes me the toughest guy in the business.
Right,
it's because I eat this stuff, I get on fire.
Pat,
I want to just maul and crunch, and John is going to have some to see. And he and I are going to eat them alive.
Right.
They're going to feel our sweat. It's going to be hot. Look at the sweat on my brow.
Yeah, John.
That's how it's going
to
be.
John, if I can come back to you. In a recent interview, John, may I just say... In a recent interview, you were quoted as saying, British wrestlers are no threat to you and that we have nothing. Now, what do you mean by that?
I think that's sort of self-explanatory, isn't it? You're practically falling down, eating a bit of a snack.
Look at him.
You'll be growing hair in your chest there.
Well, I don't think Tony Sinclair or Crusher Mason or any of our other great wrestlers would have anything to say about that. Yeah.
We could grow some hair on his chest and on his head, couldn't we?
That's fine. All right. Okay. While we're talking tag, have you ever met the Roadrunners?
Listen. The Road Runners? You mean the Road Warriors?
The Road Warriors. That's the team.
The preview you were going to show us.
Have you ever met
the Road Warriors? When I met the Road Warriors, they stayed in Puerto Rico 2 weeks and they didn't want to know me. And they have got more on the ball than what you're talking about. Your British wrestlers.
You know, you got the name right, Road Runners, because by the time we're finished with them, they are going to be the Road Runners. Do you hear that out there, you boys?
All right. Well, we're going to cut now and have a look physically at the Road Warriors.
Have some more of this. It'll make him...
Not just yet, Pat. Thanks. I'll pass on that.
Play it to you. Any more better than I can talk to you about this food here. You see this? This is your British diet. I think you call it fish and chips. You know what I call it? Garbage. How can anybody eat this and even talk about it? Look at this stuff. Slime, that's what it is. Brown slime. How can anybody eat this sort of stuff? And could you eat any of this stuff here and think you'd ever come out of anything of that? Look at that stuff. Look at it.
You know, Big John.
That's what happens to British wrestlers.
You know, Big John. You know, Big John, when I look at you doing that, and I look at this poor wimp of a boy here, and I think, what future's this kid got?
That's what he's been eating.
I mean, look at him. He's been eating this garbage.
He's of independence. And it's not the 18th century, we're talking 1986, here February. Two colossuses of the canvas from the other side of the Atlantic, two of our English boys with hearts like lions, who are going to take these two giants on. This is definitely a battle of the biggies.
Yes, there they are, Johnny South and Sandy Scott.
There's a...
Johnny South, of course, Maxie, Manchester-based star of Irish descent, along with one of the most durable home heavyweights, and has proved himself well capable of testing any of the invading overseas contenders. And these two particular ones, my goodness me.
It's off! It's gone off! We've not even started the countdown and it's off! Well, and Pat Barrett moves in! Sandy Scott in trouble! Three men in the ring. Out goes Pat Barrett, Mighty John Quinn in. Sandy Scott takes a vicious chop to the throat. And Quinn comes over. Yes! The combination work from these two guys from the other side of the water. The water being Atlantic. Diabolical. Footwork from Bone Crusher Pat Barrett. Sandy Scott. Get him wound up.
Sandy Scott, as with fellow Scott Cullen, who had Moran defeated to win the title, this bout is very much a matter of national honour for a fiercely patriotic Glaswegian Scott. I don't think he's going to stand any messing about. Johnny South in now.
Double work. Johnny South told to get out. Quinn holding on.
They've forgot the rope. They've got their own signals for getting back in. A touch of the hands.
But this is America. This is American All In, Vince. And we're not used to some of this here. Our boys are going to have to go pretty heavy. Abdominal work there. Sandy Scott in excruciating pain. Oh, and that tells it all. Our camera's there where the action is. Aided to his feet by his hair by Mighty John Quinn. The king of quips. Bounce out. Oh.
Now you see the both of them. We're back here.
Yes,
I know.
But what's happening here now, please? Why are we having these three men at once? Totally unfair. And we saw that with our cameras. Casey couldn't catch it. It was out of Casey's vision. I must hold my hands up. Oh, yes, and we're bouncing back now. Johnny South taking care of business with Quinn.
Well, he's got a score to settle.
Yes, he certainly has. He had a lovely warm-up. Headbutt. Oh, Quinn. Ha-ha. Yes, by the beard. Bow, right-hander, headmare, over we go, Pat Barrett, totally out of order, Barrett in the ring there, totally out of order, wrenches at Johnny South's nose, his upper eye is going for our eye work, not high work, eye work.
Oh, you can't.
And
we
see that
this
combination, isn't that filth, the filth that this is happening here. just forced that man's head directly onto Pat Barrett's knee. Elbow to the head. Johnny South going south of the border. Goes for the cover. Cat springs out. Pat Barrett, not a sleeper.
The sleeper could welcome into this this evening.
Well, if he does it, it is good night, nurse. End of story, and we'll wrap up all over.
2-4.
Oh, you see the combination made by these two pros.
Two pros indeed. Combination rubbish. They're just doing their own thing. They don't fight to rules.
We have a formula for fear here. We're talking double trouble at the Victoria Hall Handley. Johnny South in distress, goes straight fingers for the thighs. Doesn't mean a thing. He's like hitting two tree trunks. Neck wrench, going for the beard. He's going for the beard. He's got the beard. He's got Quinn's. No, missed it. Missed his chance. More work from Quinn. See how they bounce this around? Do you see how they bounce this around, Vince?
This is marvellous.
The tagging is diabolically out of order. Casey making sure Mighty John's out of the ring. Pat Barrett goes for the cover. One, two, no, he's...
A flip out. He said to Casey, where were you?
Yeah, I know, but you see how quick he bounced. One, two, bap, and it was all over. Fish, we could see that. Oh, yes, and Sandy Scott taking some pain. More double work from these two. May I say, diabolical. Guys, that's wild.
First public warning.
First public warning.
And Quinn's doing his own little thing while it's all going on.
Barrett out.
Trouble here. Reverse. Double Nelson.
And Barrett pulling him back. We saw that. Quinn going for body check. Sandy Scott totally frustrated in the other corner. Unable to tag his partner, completely out of range. Our men sticking totally to the rules. Blow for blow. Come on, Johnny South. I never like to show a bias here, Vince, but come on, let's have a bit of fairness here. Johnny South fighting back for Britain.
They think fairs are swinging around about Maxton.
1-2, and he went for the cover, and Barrett intervened. Frank Casey chastises. Now Sandy Scott, fresh from his corner, frustrated but fresh, says, let's get it on. Sandy Scott in black, the mighty John Quinn in blue with the beard. A ring up a Bluto. Windpipe work from Quinn. Quinn doing none of his own. Pat Barrett, I thought it. No, he's waiting to get in. Barrett just loves to get in here. Now Johnny South now has intervened. Now we've got double trouble in the ring. Oh, wow, there we go. Sandy Scott gets a double posting. Twice the velocity.
I believe his head's bursting like a seam. Now he's taking the ring.
Yeah, there we go. Barrett now. Trying to take our corner post cover off.
Little bit of rollerball Rocco stuff. Ooh, dear goodness me.
Look at the size
of
this.
Head. He split his head open.
His head is split wide open. Quinn, this colossus of the canvas. He lives on a diet of furniture. I don't believe it. And Pat Barrett, the stuff he forced down my throat, I still can't speak properly. Oh, double arms against the throat. The combination work. Oh, look at that shot. Look at that shot. This is so gory. It's incredible. And still working on the wound. Working on that wound, and the man's eye is split wide open. Pat Barrett going heavily for that open wound. What is the appeal? Is it over? It can't be over. Oh, no.
And Johnny South. The ring.
Johnny South's appealing. Oh, no, they're going to put him outside. Oh, over we go. And Sandy Scott, after a terrible, ferocious beating, is thrown from the ring. Our Our crowd are going crazy. We've got a riot in the ring. There are people saying, come on, I'll take you on. Look at this. There's a man at the front saying, come on, I'll get down here. Look, our cameras are where the action is. People going crazy here for Mighty John Quinn. Sandy Scott, unable to go on, his face torn asunder. Mighty John Quinn goading the crowd. Pat Barrett on stage here. It's still going off. I don't believe this. What is it? What?
Well, everything's happening here. The whole lot. There's a fellow at the ring.
There's a riot. Everybody's going off.
Sandy Scott's outside the ring. He's being carried away. He's taken no further part in this. And we've got two. We've got three fellas here now at the side of the ring fighting Pat Barrett. Three of the customers. We've got a riot.
He's going to put the sleeper on.
He's done it.
Has he done the sleeper?
He's done the sleeper.
The sleeper is on. We have had a riot. Oh, I don't believe this. Man's inhumanity to man totally exploited. And we can see it here now with screen sport.
Well, I said, what, Mel? Look at this. Whoa, that's it.
Ring-a-ding. He's gone for a submission and he's got that over. That is a riot. We've a riot at the Victoria Hall.
Unbelievable.
These two deadly formula for fear merchants. I can't believe it. Double trouble from stateside.
Well, there you are, Maxie. Another fabulous night of wrestling here at the Victoria Hall, Hanley.
Absolutely sensational, Vince, as always.
And indeed.
Let me have that microphone. People have heard your drivel enough. Hey, we're back here, the dynamic duo, Big Bad John and Pat.
Talk, Bone
baby.
Crusher Barrett. Did you see what happened out there? I keep telling you about what you people got up there for gray matter. You got nothing. Nothing up there but a fog.
I'm going to show you people things you've never seen. Those wrestlers we had in there, I felt sorry for the man.
One fella claiming to be some kind of a champion of some sort?
You know what I don't understand, Big John? Is when I put the sleeper hold, they all scream and moan and stop doing that. I want to put them all to sleep. That's all I want to do. Cure their insomnia. Don't slap me on the back. Don't slap me on the back. I'm warning you.
I think we've just shown the British public just what comes from America.
Thank you. Pat Barrett and Mighty John Quinn, a very, very deadly duo, Vince, we've got there.
Are they going to be accepted in Great Britain? That's what you've got to ask
yourself. We'll think about that when we talk about Tony Sinclair.
Anyway, we'll say goodnight. God bless you here from hell of it. Oh, thank you, Brian.
Lovely.
It's for you. Mail from you.
Screen Sport, Knutsford, and it is postmarked Osaka, Japan.
See, satellite wrestling gets everywhere. Isn't that marvellous?
Everywhere. And this is wild.
This is?
Yes.
Well, oh no!
That is.
Oh no! Yes, I think they all know what that is. The Maniac's Rollerball, headband, Rollerball Rocco.
Rocco's headband.
Personal letter to you, and back soon, Beasley.